On behalf of the Cuba program at Columbia University's Institute of Latin American Studies, I want to welcome our panelists, Chris Washburne, Ben Lapidus, and Jose Fernandez, to this evening's discussion of Latin jazz. This is a topic that has been explored most recently in two books, one by Chris Washburne and one by Ben Lapidus. And of course, as musicians, they have been exploring it in many different genres, etc. And our friend Jose Fernandez, who is a jazz buff, has also been analyzing jazz for some time. I'm Meg Crahan, director of the Cuba program at Columbia University. And it's my pleasure to introduce Chris Washburne, who is a trombonist, a composer, a band leader, and an educator, and a colleague of mine at Columbia University. He received his doctorate in musicology from Columbia University, where he is the founder and director of Columbia's Louis Armstrong Jazz Performance Program. And he has published numerous articles and also a previous book entitled Sounding Salsa, Performing Latin Music in New York. And the most recent book, which I referred to, is Latin Jazz, The Other Jazz. As a trombonist, he has toured extensively with various groups in Europe, the Americas, Africa, Asia, and the Caribbean. This obviously was pre-pandemic. He has commissioned and premiered over 20 contemporary compositions for trombone and has performed on over 150 recordings. In addition, he has performed with Tito Puente, Eddie Palmieri, Justin Timberlake, Ruben Blades, the Manhattan Chamber Orchestra, Gloria Estefan, Chico O'Farrell, and many others. And tonight he is going to join us. And I'm sure out of this encounter, there will come many fruitful music collaborations. Chris?
Thank you very much and welcome everyone. I'm so grateful for the invitation to have the opportunity to speak to you all. And I'm so pleased to see so many familiar names that I haven't been able to see for quite some time now. Attending tonight, and I just want to shout out to, I can't name all of them, but shout out to all of you, and I hope that this is the beginning of reconnecting. I'm going to share my screen with you as I have some slides and also some music to play for you. So let me put that up right now. So this is a labor of love for me. Latin jazz is a music that I've been performing for close to 35 years now, and the last 30 years in New York City. And I have been wanting to write this book for some time. And it's a book that kind of has been brewing for probably the last 25 years as I've been growing more and more frustrated by what I've read in the jazz literature and how I've seen the music that I love and I play and the musicians who have dedicated so much of their lives to it be time and time again either omitted from the jazz historical narrative or marginalized in either bookings or in clubs or not having the same kind of opportunities that other jazz musicians have. And I always thought that was so curious. And as I decided to embark upon this project, I wanted to have their voices be heard and resonate loudly in this book, but also to take an exploration of the history and try to understand why this music typically is marginalized, erased, dismissed, and omitted. And kind of to rethink that and rethink our relationship to it. So I call the book Latin Jazz, The Other Jazz, but of course I'm referring to music that has a lot of different names and some of the various labels that have come about over the last 100 years or so are Latin jazz, Afro-Cuban jazz, Afro-Latin jazz, Caribbean jazz, jazz Latin, cubop, sometimes just called jazz, and or called by the variety of dance steps that were associated with the rhythms in this music. And of course, labeling music is a political act, right? It's a way of genre, and genre contestation is a way, it's a marketing tool, it's a marketing strategy, but it's also a way to segregate, separate, and pigeonhole. And thinking about the lives of the musicians that I've worked with over the many years, all of them resist pigeonholing. All of them resist labeling and feel as though that it's rather limiting. And so that's another aspect of this book that I wanted to explore. When I talk about Latin jazz, and I'll just use Latin jazz as one of those terms, I think it's very problematic, and I think that all of the terms that I just had up on the screen are problematic. But I do conceive of this body of music kind of existing in this, in an intercultural space, and I call it the Latin jazz continuum, where on one side of it you have traditional musics of the Caribbean, South and Central America, the traditional folk, dance, and popular musics, and classical traditions, and all of their performance traditions. And then oftentimes there's another side of this continuum that is viewed as like the jazz musics and the performance practices that are there. And of course, this is a complete artificial way of thinking about it, but it's a way that a lot of people think about this in the sense that both of these kind of, both ends of this continuum are dialogic in terms of their relationship. There's a dialogue of influence that goes back and forth and has been for many, many years, jazz being the most popular music or the popular music of the day in the 19-teens and 20s globally. And of course, musicians are world travelers, and musicians always have their ears in the air and to the ground and through the walls, and use the raw materials of other different styles to enhance their own and through innovation. But the music that we're going to talk about today, or I'm talking about today, exists in this intercultural space in between, somewhere along this continuum that shares influences from both sides of the continuum. Even up to 2005, and this is the cover of Jazz Times in 2005, many people referring to the popular press, and I think many people hold this, and jazz musicians as well, that the birth of Latin jazz happened in the mid-1940s with this gentleman here, Dizzy Gillespie, one of the greatest jazz trumpet players of all time, and his collaborations with the Cuban, Afro-Cuban percussionist, Chano Pozo. And so this is still being kind of, put out there and part of the dialogue that permeates around and informs this music and perceptions of this music. And here's some pictures. That was a picture that was used, the announcement of this talk, which is also in my book. That's Chano Pozo playing a conga drum and talking to Dizzy Gillespie, that's sitting on the couch, that looks like he's got two clave sticks, playing claves and jamming backstage with Chano Pozo. And indeed, in the 1940s, they were very, very important in terms of a collaboration they did with the Dizzy Gillespie Band, where they were using the big band traditions in New York City and also the variety of Afro-Cuban traditions that Chano brought to the band, as well as being informed by one of Dizzy Gillespie's very close friends, trumpeter Mario Bauza, who was the musical director of the Machito Band. And he was the one that introduced these two, and they were very successful in terms of the music they wrote. Dizzy was at the height of his career, kind of at the exact same time that bebop was hitting, that he had been collaborating with Charlie Parker. And him bringing Chano Pozo along was really, at first, almost a way of enhancing his performance. He was headlining at Carnegie Hall. And so he had some music written, and Chano was brought along to perform. But what happened really quickly is Dizzy Gillespie was someone with a global perspective, Their collaboration, though short-lived, had a profound impact on jazz and the jazz that was made at this time and jazz that came after, in terms of most musicians consciously attempting to infuse their music with various types of Latin American and Caribbean rhythms, in particular Afro-Cuban rhythms at first. So it's partially true, but in my book, I call this about the third birth of Latin jazz, because as I started to go back in time and to explore the historical record, I found something very, very different. What we get in the 1930s was an interview with Jelly Roll Morton, a Creole pianist from New Orleans, who was one of the early innovators in jazz and one of the people that kind of created jazz as we know it, set the parameters. But he made a comment, being a musician from New Orleans, saying that, and many of you that are tuned in tonight know this, is that he claimed that jazz was not jazz without a Spanish tinge. And what did he mean by a Spanish tinge? Well, he was referring to a lot of the rhythmic foundations underpinning New Orleans music. But not only the rhythmic foundations, but also the repertoire, also the kind of cultural components, and the aesthetics that were part of New Orleans. And of course, New Orleans was a central hub for the emergence of jazz. It's not the only hub. Jazz was really a global phenomenon and was a global phenomenon quite quickly, but we need to explore the history of New Orleans to trace back why a musician who was active in the teens and the 20s thought as though that it was important to mention the Spanish tinge. And of course, for him at that time, Spanish meant the Spanish Caribbean and Latin American countries that spoke Spanish. And he had a number of compositions where he tried to emphasize that. And I think one of the easiest and ways to hear this is a piece of music that I just want to play a short excerpt from. This is called New Orleans Blues. And I want you to listen to the rhythmic framing. It's a solo piano rendition, but I want you to listen very carefully to the groove. And this is what he's referring to. This is what the Spanish tinge is. If you listen to his left hand and its interactions with the right, you're going to hear this boom, boom, ba, boom, 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 or boom, ba, boom, 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 ba, boom, boom, boom. And those rhythms were kind of rhythms that you see throughout the Caribbean, especially in Afro-Cuban music, and that they play a very prominent role in all New Orleans music. And so we also hear, at the same time in the 1930s, interviews by Duke Ellington talking about the slow blues that comes from New Orleans was really had Mexican rhythms. He was referring to it, just kind of conflating all of the Spanish-speaking Central and Latin American and Caribbean influences into one. But he emphasized that it was really some part of that rhythmic foundation of jazz was not necessarily coming directly from African-American culture, but there was more to it. It was much more complex. Of course, the main innovators at this time in New Orleans were Creole and African-American. So not taking anything away from those contributions, but there was more to the foundations that they were drawing from and part of the cultural climate of New Orleans. But then if we look even earlier back into the music, I came across this, which I found quite remarkable. And this is a New York Times advertisement from March 9th, 1917. And this gives us, this is like time travel. Like we can go back in time and imagine what the people that were at Rise and Weber's at Columbus Circle, the Paradise Club, which by the way, is right next door where the current Jazz at Lincoln Center is. So there's a long period, a long history of a lot of jazz happening right on that block. And I find this so fascinating. It was one of the main performance venues for white audiences in New York at that time. 1917 is the same year that the original Dixieland Jazz Band records the first jazz record. And it starts to really create a global phenomenon. And this is the beginning of it. And we can also see how jazz at that time was marketed and was viewed by the white imagination, because in this particular case, it says daily at 4:30, an entire novelty. We have seance tea dances. We have karma in mediumistic dances of the Orient, whatever that is. And then we have Tancita Guerra, a gypsy crystal gazer, so you can have a full experience. And then there's the original jazz dance, and check that out. And the Cuban dance song. White people in 1917 were dancing to the Cuban dance song, which shares some of the same rhythms that you just heard that Jelly Roll Morton was playing. Why is that? Because so many of those rhythms were played by the early jazz bands and had been playing for some time. And the history is too complicated to go through all of the iterations and why this is in this short presentation. Hope if you're interested, you'll read both of Ben's and my books. But if we keep going down further, we see Ouija boards will be provided for everyone. And not only that, who are the bands that are being featured here? Well, there were two. And look who was there, the original Dixieland Jazz Band. And this was their first big gig in New York. And the hit song that they played was from one of their first recordings, The Tiger Rag. I want to play a short excerpt from The Tiger Rag right now. And I want you to listen to the rhythms that are in this particular cut. Right? Let me just move this down. Right when we get to the point of the most exciting part of the track. So what would happen is oftentimes jazz bands would start off kind of a little bit slower, a little bit more subdued, and then they would get to the point where they'd slowly elevate the energy for the dancers. And by the time you get to the emotional height of the track, that would oftentimes happen towards the end of it. And they would also, oftentimes early jazz musicians in New Orleans would refer to that as the hot chorus. Eventually, it would be transformed into the shout choruses and the big bands later on. But it was where you would really get down in the dancing. And this was the exact place that typically jazz bands would turn to Caribbean rhythms and Afro-Cuban rhythms, like you heard in the New Orleans blues. And in this particular case, you'll hear what we'll call a clave-like type of rhythm. And the clave rhythm is this. And this rhythm serves as kind of a rhythmic organizing principle of Afro-Cuban music. It can be heard in other places, but it really is one of the defining sounds trace a piece of music that's associated with Afro-Cuban traditions. But let's listen to this. You'll hear it. The shot choruses or the hot choruses always are launched by some instrument kind of like screaming, and you'll hear that with the trombone and the trumpet, and then you'll hear this rhythm. I'll try to clap along, although it won't be in sync because we're on Zoom, and Zoom is one of the most ungrooviest mediums of all time, so you can't really groove on Zoom. But anyway, you'll hear where it happens. Precisely the moment, that is the Spanish tinge that Jelly Roll Morton was talking about. This was the number one jazz band, granted five white guys, and there weren't musicians of color that were recorded until a couple years later, which shows the kind of the institutionalized racism of the recording industry at that time. But nonetheless, they were very important because they were some of the first recorded musicians that toured and kind of spread the language of jazz around. going back to this slide then, but it wasn't them that were the earliest. What we see is that when we get to, in the aftermath of that, we get a series of musicians that come along from Cuba that are playing Latin rhythms. But why is it that the first jazz band from New Orleans has these rhythms? Why is Jelly Roll Morton talking about this? And we have to kind of go back into history. And to save a little time, I'm just going to go right back to the beginning to try to figure out what the relationship of the Caribbean is to New Orleans. And when did the Caribbean, was it infused with these rhythms? And so the close relationship of New Orleans with the Caribbean began, of course, with the first wave of enslaved peoples to reach its port. In 1716 to 1717, roughly 3,500 enslaved peoples arrived from the islands of Guadeloupe, Martinique, and Saint-Domingue, the island that is now known as Haiti in the Dominican Republic. This initial importation infused New Orleans in the lower Mississippi Valley with a nascent Afro-Caribbean black population that actually outnumbered the white settlers that were there at the time, and established a neo-African belief systems and practices rooted in what would become later known as names like voodoo and Santeria, a legacy that is still present in New Orleans today. The enslaved West Indian peoples also brought a number of Afro-Caribbean music and dance traditions that would play fundamental roles in the public performances in Congo Square in the ensuing years. And Congo Square happened to be a place, one of the few places in the United States that allowed West African drumming and drumming traditions to continue throughout the colonial period. By 1718, the French had established New Orleans as a central hub for their slave trade. However, they soon found the enslaved people from the West Indies to be rebellious and troublesome because of the shared religious and cultural practices, and then began importing people from Senegambia. Why? Because these folks had a very strong and cohesive cultural expression and a shared cultural belief system that was threatening to the colonialists. But is one of the reasons why early musical expression that starts to come out of New Orleans becomes infused with some of the ideas that they played. And one of the main dances, the main rhythms that was played in Congo Square and was documented by a number of people, was eventually known as the Bambula. Robert Ferris Thompson has traced this rhythm to the key Congo peoples of West of Africa, and it's called a rhythm called the Mbila Makanu, which is a kind of incantation to dance. But the main rhythm to that is da ba da ga da ga da ga da. Which is the same rhythm that Jelly Roll Morton was infusing New Orleans blues with. And of course, if you slow that down, you get boom, boom, ping, boom, 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 ping, boom, you get the tango. You slow that down, you get the habanera from Cuba. It's a rhythm that proliferates throughout Latin America and throughout the Caribbean, and also reggaeton. Everybody talks about reggaeton being something new. It's not new. Its origins are in 1716, and so is Latin jazz. And that is the true birth of Latin jazz. It allowed for musicians like Don Aspiaso and his Havana Casino Orchestra to come from Cuba and perform the peanut vendor for white audiences in Midtown and go to the number one hit record by the first Cuban band. It allowed Louis Armstrong to come and record that piece 3 months later, and rise to number 4 in the charts, and then Duke Ellington as well. And why is that? It was still called jazz when Louis Armstrong played that Cuban piece. What was it called when Don Aspiaso played? People had a problem with that. He was a jazz musician, but also he played Cuban dances, so what was it called? They had no idea. So they made up a name. They called it Rumba, but they spelled it with an H because the RCA Victor record executives didn't speak Spanish and they didn't even take the time to learn. At this point, that label stuck. When Louis Armstrong played it, it was still a rumba, but it was also part of the jazz. Duke Ellington recorded it. 75 other jazz artists and pop artists from the United States recorded it within the first couple years. But when you buy Louis Armstrong compilations, typically that song is omitted from it. And as we move forward, we see more and more of these type of musical expressions being erased. And it wasn't until we get to Dizzy Gillespie, where Dizzy Gillespie starts to say, this is a new kind of music. And they say, well, what kind of music is it? And he called it Cubop, Cuba and bebop put together, because Dizzy Gillespie was a savvy marketer. And he knew to have come up with a new and most improved thing, that would be a way of selling. And indeed, it was the best thing that could have happened to Latin jazz, and it's also one of the worst things, because it ensured the fact that it would always be viewed as something separate, apart from the jazz tradition. But what I just showed you in these last 15 minutes is that these rhythms and these that are foundational, it is what makes jazz swing. It is what made those people dance and get down on those dance floors in the teens, in the 20s, in the 1930s. I just have a few more minutes and then I'll step back and let Ben talk, but I just want to read a short excerpt from my book, from the epilogue. Massive diversity is always the key to the healthiest of ecologies. This is true for nature and human expressivity. The diversity of the rich social and cultural fabric of jazz's past is precisely why the music has been able to thrive in so many places and in so many unique ways. Indeed, jazz was the music that emerged in the aftermath of the last major pandemic we had in this world, the Spanish flu, because it is adaptable and it bodes well for the future of the music when we get out of the current pandemic that we're in. But not embracing the diversity prevents us from hearing the multitude of voices that collectively make the music so compelling. Jazz's sound reverberates in tangled histories that encompass a tapestry of racial distinctions and blurred lines between geographical divides. It is a product of the black, brown, tan, mulatto, beige, and white experience throughout the Americas and the Caribbean. When I say Americas, I mean North, South, and Central. To deny this is to not deny the resilience and fortitude of our foremothers and forefathers of jazz. It denies the music's open aesthetic that we've inherited from African American culture. And it denies what truly reverberates in every jazz solo from stages across the globe. This book acknowledges, pays tribute to, and celebrates the diversity of culture, experience, and perspectives that are foundational to jazz. Thus, the music's legacy is shown to transcend far beyond stylistic distinction and national borders and the imposition of the black-white racial divide that has only served to maintain the status quo in the United States. The reality of jazz is much more nuanced. Music traditions are often portrayed by means of a metaphor of a tree. It is constructed like a family tree. And the roots, the trunk, the branches demonstrate kinship relationships of influence and indebtedness. What you see on the screen now was conceived by flautist Herbie Mann, a white jazz musician from the United States who dedicated much of his professional career to playing Latin jazz. In typical fashion, Africa is centered in the root system along the colonizing cultures of the New World. Cuba, Puerto Rico, Brazil serve as the trunk and the lowest branches in this Latin jazz tree. The outer branches encompass specific genres and major innovators, many of whom are discussed in this book. And various branches are then interconnected by musicians who are represented like vines that fluidly traverse the tree from style to style and place to place. Mann himself is depicted in that role, and he appears in two spaces in the canopy of the tree connecting jazz, Brazil, and Cuba. Conceiving of Latin jazz in this way has some benefits, as it acknowledged the shared past in a validly metaphorical way that represents the kinship relations among innovative musicians. However, once again, it relegates Latin jazz to being a separate singular tree, not necessarily connected to other conifers growing in the same forests. As a separate entity, the Latin jazz tree does not capture the full extent of the cross-pollination pollinization and intercultural exchange, the intrinsic interconnectivity, and the truly global breadth of the music. We must conceive of jazz, if we must conceive of jazz or Latin jazz in this way, we must first clarify, which species of tree are we talking about? I suggest that a better model would be the metaphor of the aspen tree. Aspen forests are not collections of individual trees, but are rather are all one organism sharing the same root system. The forest is a singular tree. Aspens are considered the second largest living organism on Earth, second only to the Great Barrier Reef. Within each sprout, the same DNA and past history are embodied. In jazz, each iteration, substyle, and performance resonates the music's past, its roots, and its social history reaching back to 1716. Here's a picture of an aspen forest in Colorado and also the root systems, and you can see that all of the roots touch. It's just one tree. They're all interconnected. I was playing at the Blue Note in 1999 with the Tito Puente Orchestra. Unbeknownst to Tito, one of his best friends decided to show up and hang out. Max Roach, one of the greatest jazz drummers in the 20th century. When they saw each other, they embraced. They sat arm in arm, giggling like children, sharing stories, interconnected stories from their lives and their shared experiences. This is what an aspen forest looks like in the jazz world. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Chris. We will have questions at the end of our three speakers. So if you have a question now that you wish to pose to Chris, please put it into the chat function, which you can find on the bottom of your screen. We will now hear from Ben Lapidus, who is a musician, a composer, and a scholar. He teaches in the Department of Art and Music at John Jay College, as well as at the Graduate Center of the City University of New York. And he recently published the volume, New York and the International Sound of Music, 1940 to 1990. He is the recipient of the Latin Jazz USA Lifetime Achievement Award. And he has had a tremendously varied musical experience, and he plays a wide variety of instruments. Lapidus has said that the music he performs, teaches, and writes about is distinctly New York in character. And for a long time, he believes there has been a movement that's been happening in New York where people from throughout the Caribbean and Latin America come and interact with the jazz musicians here. And that combination has led to a lot of developments, not just in Latin jazz, but also in jazz in general. He has recorded or joined in recording sessions on 50 separate occasions and has recorded 8 studio records. He received his doctorate from the City University, its Graduate Center, and he is a very accomplished musician himself. I think I counted 30 different instruments or something to that point. Ben? Speak.
Always have to remember to unmute. Thanks, Meg, yeah. and thanks, Chris. Great to be here. I have to just correct the pronunciation of my last name because my father's watching. So, Dad, this one's for you. Great to be here, as Chris said, with I see so many familiar names and also family members, so it's great. So, and I'm really glad that Chris spoke about what he spoke about because I guess I can focus more on New York, which is what my book is about. And hopefully in the conversation afterwards, we can get into some of those things, because as I was taking notes, there were a lot of, it brought to mind a lot of really important things that I have come to in my own work. And like Chris, my book is a product of coming out of a musical family, a father who played jazz and Latin music professionally in New York and elsewhere, and being surrounded by my elders in my neighborhood who took me under their wing, some of them who are with us still to this day and some of them who are not, but who were very active as Latin jazz musicians and playing all types of Latin dance music. So like Chris, my the impetus for me to write my book was really talking to all these musicians, asking the same kind of questions. How come people don't talk about this? How come people don't seize on these facts that we have as musicians? But rather than looking towards jazz, I think I was focusing more on the narrative of Latin music that we have in New York and the general narrative of Latin music that is told over and over again without questioning some of its founding facts, or as I would say, mythology. So I'll get started by sharing some images and video as well. Let's go here to, here we go. And if we look, let me just figure out why I can't get this to go. Here we go. Here we go. Nope. Much better. If we look at New York City, we have this confluence of musicians from throughout the Caribbean, as Meg mentioned in my introduction, that it's just so tied to the history of New York. Some of us take it for granted, others of us don't. Here's a street naming for Arsenio Rodriguez that was put together by Ralph Mendez and a bunch of other people, including Larry Harlow. Here you see Alfredo Chocolate Armenteros in the center with Arsenio Rodriguez's niece and grand nephew. Of course, we have, when Chocolate passed, a street named after him. And of course, La Lupe has her own street on 140th Street. The great Cuban vocalist, Lupe Victoria Yoli. And of course, the Puerto Rican cuatrista, Yomo Toro on 162nd Street. And of course, Charlie Palmieri, a very important pianist who played danzón, who played jazz, who played all types of Latin music, East 112th Street. Tito Puente, Chris's employer, on East 110th Street. That is to say that New York City is very much tied to Latin music in a physical way. Here's a recording from 1941 of El Negro Ñañamboro, performed by Mariano Mercerón, who was from Santiago. This is 1941. Now I play this recording because the vocalist for this is Camilo Rodriguez, who is from Panama. Mercedón is from Cuba. And here's Machito version recorded here in New York City around 1956. And moving ahead, I want to show you how in 1966, a group of Afro-Puerto Ricans that was led by Sonny Calderon, or Joe Cuba, as he was chose for his stage name, did a song that was kind of a response to El Negro Ñañamboro that Jimmy Sabater sings, Puerto Rican vocalist, composer. He says, "I am not the Negro Ñañamboro, but I have my own ache, I have my own swing, I have my own essence." And this is a result of being a New Yorker, being a Puerto Rican, being Afro-Caribbean, and it starts off like this. No soy negro ñañamboro, y si toco se me abre, y gracias le doy al hombre, porque tengo un poco de clave. Yo guaré, chévere está el ambiente, en el grupo de yo. Pongan atención, señores, si no saben que no suba. Bien, 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 bien lo dice el viejo adagio.
siembra tu palo de almendra, que el que sabe, 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 y el que no, que se quede bruto, coro ya, oya, coro.
Soy neno, ñaña, poro.
Coro ya, oya, coro.
So I guess we could say we're getting even more meta as we move forward, because in the next example I'd like to play for you is a band here in New York City that was active in the 70s, broke up as a result of having traveled to Cuba at a time when it was considered not a good thing to do politically, and also within the Cuban American community it was seen as a bad thing to travel to Cuba. This is prior to when you had massive flights in 1978 of Cuban Americans returning home to Cuba before the Antonio Maceo brigades. This is when Típica 73, which was co-led by a great Cuban American musician, Sonny Bravo, and Johnny Rodriguez, they actually went to Cuba, they came back, the band broke up, lost a lot of work as a result, death threats, etc. But going from our original recording that I played for you, this is the son of the original singer that I played for you from Panama singing with Típica 73 that wound up going to Cuba years later, singing another song. So this is all just to reiterate this particular point in the Circum-Caribbean that we have. If you want to include in anywhere in the Caribbean, be it Puerto Rico, Cuba, Dominican Republic, Haiti, Panama, and New Orleans, as Chris pointed out, I'm gonna in my book, and what I really feel is that New York is a major place in the Circum-Caribbean formation of Latin jazz and Latin music. The first recording of Cuban music ever made in the history of Cuban music was made here in New York City in 1899 by the singer Chalia Herrera, and many recordings made by Cuban groups were made in New York City and Camden, New Jersey, like the Sexteto Habanero, recorded in 1926 in Camden, New Jersey. The same thing with Miguel Matamoros and his trio. So really this link is forged historically. We're talking about well over 100 years of recordings being made in New York City. The Fania All-Stars are often credited as being the first band to perform in Yankee Stadium. And if you look at this advertisement, I was able to find, this is an advertisement in the newspaper from the Pedro Piquito Marcano collection at the Center for Puerto Rican Studies. You'll see that, I think this is around 1952, that it was actually Miguelito Valdez who was performing there with Johnny Seguí. Johnny Seguí was Puerto Rican, but Miguelito Valdez from Cuba. And this was at Yankee Stadium. A few years later, this is the 1963 Major League Latino All-Star game that happened at Yankee Stadium that most people don't talk about. This is when the Yankee Stadium was still in the Polo Grounds. And after this concert, Tito Rodriguez, Tito Puente, and La Lupe performed for the ticket holders. So generally speaking, these are pieces of history that people don't really talk about when they talk about Latin music in New York. Chris was talking about the clave before, and I think if we get into discussion about clave, I'll come back to this. I wanted to point out the fact that you have musicians from throughout the Caribbean performing in all types of ensembles, not just jazz ensembles. Here you have Carlos Alomar on electric guitar with Pablo El Indio on congas. This is with David Bowie. Of course, when Daniel Ponce came here, he was playing with the Rolling Stones and also with Herbie Hancock. If you listen carefully to Rocket, which I probably don't have time to play today, Daniel Ponce can be heard playing the aconcolo drum, which was the third of the three bata drums, the smallest. So a very common thing, but not talked about, perhaps as Chris suggests, of involvement of Caribbean musicians in all different types of genres, not just with jazz, classical music, show music, you name it, popular music of the day. Clave, we'll get to that, I guess, later. This is an important Cuban musician who is responsible for educating many, many musicians here in New York City. He came to New York in the 1920s from Baracoa, the most eastern part of Cuba. If you stand on the shore of Baracoa at night, you can see the lights of Haiti from across the water. Alberto Socarrás taught solfeo, sight singing, Do, Re, Mi, Fa, Sol, La, Si, Do, if you're not a musician, to some of the best musicians in New York City who are playing on the scene to this day. He taught everybody, Cubans, Puerto Ricans, Panamanians, Americans who are, had no Latin heritage. He was a jazz musician. He played with Clarence Williams, arguably has the first jazz flute solo in the 1920s. This is another important musician who ties in also to, Chris was talking about Jelly Roll Morton and the Spanish Tinge. Here is the Spanish Tinge and Jelly Roll Morton's touring band in the 1920s and 30s. This is Nicholas Goodwin Rodriguez, who also taught a number of important piano players to this day, like Oscar Hernandez and Pulpo Colon and Sergio Rivera. Nick Rodriguez played in Jelly Roll Morton's band, and he played with Louis Armstrong, and he was a good friend with the Lion Smith. He was Panamanian from Bocas del Toro. And he made his money on those gigs, and he enrolled in Juilliard and got himself a degree in music. And he taught theory to a lot of musicians, Cuban, Latino, whatever you would like. This is another important educator for music. This is Victoria Hernandez, Rafael Hernandez's sister. This is Maria Luisa Lecomte, who taught a number of important jazz musicians as well. She was married to the Cuban pianist Luis Varona, and their son Luis Varona also had a successful career playing Latin jazz and dance music. This is another important instructor by the name of Fredo Mesorana, who taught Hilton Ruiz. And Chris mentioned the area around Lincoln Center, which is where John Jay is. This is Olavo Alen, the great Cuban musicologist who grew up here in New York City before leaving Cuba, leaving to go back to Cuba in 1962. If you look on the left, you'll see his father, Osvaldo Alen, who was here in New York City playing at the Cuban restaurant called El Liborio, which was in that neighborhood, San Juan Hill, which is an important neighborhood filled with Cubans and Puerto Ricans, and many of them were great musicians. This is Margaret Bonds, who taught Eddie Palmieri and a number of other musicians. This is Mary Lou Williams, great jazz pianist, who was a professor for the deceased pianist Hilton Ruiz, great Puerto Rican musician who played jazz very, very well, recorded with many, many jazz artists, and also played Latin music. The importance of music education in terms of Latin jazz and Latin music in New York is really crucial. And there's this myth that all Latin musicians and performers of Latin music are educated at UCLA, the University of the Corner of Lexington Avenue. But while the energy of the music might be coming from that direction, the level of study and discipline is quite serious. So this is an advertisement for a workshop back in the 1970s. You can see Gene Golden, who was the drummer for Catherine Dunham. This was a music school run by Johnny Colon. A number of fantastic musicians taught at this school, like Mario Rivera, who was my neighbor, seen up there in the upper left, and Sonny Bravo, and Andy Gonzalez, and educated many musicians who have gone on to this day to have tremendous careers as playing both Latin jazz and Cuban popular music and salsa. New York was also the site where people would have books about how to play Latin music and Latin jazz. This is a piano method book by the great Puerto Rican pianist Nora Morales, published in the early 50s. Here's a percussion book that tells you about the clave and tells you how to play the timbal. That was published by his brother, Humberto Morales. And of course, here's the rumba in Central Park. A lot of people, if you go to the rumba on Sundays at 4 o'clock in Central Park when the weather is nice, you know, you may think, well, this is something that's only been happening for a short time. This is a picture from 1961, as you can tell from the suits. So this has been going on for a long time in New York. Of course, other types of folkloric genres, not limited to Cuba. We have bomba. This is the group of Felix Romero. There you have Eddie Bobé and Felix Sanabria. And of course, all types of expositions and events celebrating Caribbean heritage in New York City and throughout the Caribbean. This is an advertisement for one such convention that happened in 1983. Here's a magazine with Tito Puente. This was a short-lived magazine called Santeria, but there was a lot of interest in people looking to talk about and expose the heritage of this music, that it wasn't just dance music. This magazine featured interviews with musicians, talked about religion, talked about connections to Africa, etc. Latin jazz. We didn't start making congas and different percussion instruments for a while in New York, but early on in the 1920s, this gentleman right here, who was from Cuba, had a pastry shop, and it was called La Moderna, which I'm going to show you an ad for, hopefully. This is Simon Jew, and everybody who was anybody who played percussion got their instruments from this man in the La Colonia Hispana. There it is. So you can get your Gran Sartil Artículos para Navidad y Año Nuevo. You have turrones, marzipan, etc. But you can also get all your other needs for music. So this necessity to make a living, but also to play music, very interesting. The instruments that are playing, that you play Latin jazz with, like the timbales, this was the first set of timbales that Tito Puente had. They were made by a gentleman by the name of El Indio. They were hence copied and mass-produced by a number of people, such as the Leedy and Ludwig Corporation, as you can see at the bottom of this list. Some of the greatest musicians to play these instruments based here in New York City: Humberto Morales, Tito Puente, Tony Escoyes, Ubaldo Nieto. This was mass-produced percussion instrument. Then you had artisan instruments, people like Jay Barek, who is not Cuban or Latino. He was an American Jew who just loved percussion, and he handmade drums in the style of Cuba. It's very much sought after. Also, early mass production of percussion instruments. This was Frank Mesa, who was a Puerto Rican bass player who started to make drums out of fiberglass from boats. This is Junior Tirado, who made great instruments by hand as well. A lot of people sought out his instruments. And of course, Cali Rivera, whose shop was by Yankee Stadium, who made all types of percussion, particularly cowbells. The first recording, I believe, with one of his cowbells is Cheo Feliciano's Anacaona. But you can see a whole industry of musical instruments and performers. Again, not just Cuban performers, but here we have Princess Aurelia, who was a dancer who did all types of African dance, diasporic dance, as well as Cuban dance. And she was also a jazz record producer. She produced records with Charlie Rouse and Julian Priester and did shows. And this is just an advertisement for her booking from 1946. I wanted to also play an example of how jazz and Latin music are integrated through the musicians who are trying to express living in these two cultures.
Hay músicos que no están conformes en tocar un instrumento a perfección. Por ejemplo, el muchacho que les voy a presentar toca tenor, flauta y es arreglista, y tiene la ambición de algún día dirigir su propia orquesta. De San Juan, Puerto Rico, Rey Santos.
To cut off Ray Santos, there he is playing saxophone, one of the most important arrangers in Latin jazz, and recently passed. But this is really important because Ray Santos grew up in the Bronx, and he went to Juilliard and actually graduated and studied composition and was playing tenor saxophone. So I think in someone like Ray Santos, we see how this is all of this is embodied in this connection to New York. I wanted to play you two more quick things. One is, I think, an important thing to look at, because while this connection between Dizzy Gillespie and Chano Pozo is super important in the history of Latin jazz, I like to look at other examples of what other people did prior to that. For me, this is an incredible example. This is Rafael Hernandez, who was part of the Harlem Hellfighters Orchestra, which was a contingent of soldiers of color who fought in World War I under James Reese Europe, and served in as combatants as well. A number of musicians, roughly 23, 26 musicians, came from Puerto Rican municipal band background to be in the Harlem Hellfighters. That's a whole other story we could talk about. But this is a great example because there's a lot of back and forth between English and Spanish, a lot of back and forth between the guaracha and also the swing rhythms.
Un americano que fue a Puerto Rico se enamoró de una muchachita de ojos divinos y él sí la habló. No sabiendo español, un libro compró y tan solo de aquel libro esto se aprendió. Señorita, beautiful señorita, I love you. Señorita,
I think we're going to, I want to just explain this last thing, which for me is also a way to honor this musician who mentored me a lot. This concept of clave, this concept of the tumbao, the role of the anticipated bass in Latin jazz and Latin music. I think for Latin jazz musicians, we tend to see this as all interrelated, as all, as Chris pointed out, as part of the same continuum on both ends of it. And I think here you have a great example of not just of Tito Puente talking about it, but of Andy Gonzalez talking about how when he listens to James Brown, he hears the same counterpoints that he hears in Cuban music and vice versa. So I think I'll end with this.
Como las melodías de jazz y eso, pero ritmáticamente se puede hasta bailar. Porque cuando nosotros lo tocamos, maybe como un guaguancó, como un cha-cha-cha, o un son montuno, una melodía de jazz, la cogemos, la viramos a un ritmo de nosotros. Y entonces la gente que le gusta el jazz conoce la melodía y dice, ¡ay, qué chévere! Yo conozco esta melodía de John Coltrane o de fulano de tal.
I listen to James Brown the same way I listen to Arsenio. James Brown sets up counterpoint. It's the same thing. It's a different, yeah. It's like cold sweat.
Esos
son tumbados, pero eso es diferente, es americano, pero es tumbado.
Thank you, Ben. That was terrific. We are now going to have a comment from Jose Fernandez, and after that we'll open the floor for questions. But first, Jose will have a few questions of his own. And let me introduce Jose, who is a jazz connoisseur, a diplomat, and a lawyer. And he has been active in the promotion of Latin American and particularly Cuban culture in New York. He's been heavily involved in WBGO FM, which is a jazz station, as you probably know. He has also been on the board of Ballet Hispanico of New York and the Middle East Institute. He was a co-founder of Teatro Stage Fest, a two-week Latino theater festival in New York City, and was appointed a commissioner of New York's Latin media and entertainment, et cetera. On the flip side, he has a degree from Dartmouth in history, which is always a good background to be anything you want. Since I have my degree in history and also a law degree from Columbia University. So now we'll have Jose Fernandez's comment and some questions. Jose.
Thank you, Maggie, and good evening. Thanks for inviting me. And just by congratulating Chris and Ben on what I thought were two impeccably researched and well thought out books. They deal with a number of other issues than it's not just Cuban music, but more importantly, I think they're a lot of fun. These were fun books to read. And you were talking just now, Ben, about James Brown. And there's an anecdote in your book that I loved, which is, you know, Johnny Pacheco and Fania All-Stars go to Zaire for the Rumble in the Jungle with Muhammad Ali and George Foreman. And they land together with James Brown. And the local audiences are at the airport, and they're not yelling, you know, James Brown. They're yelling Pacheco, Pacheco, and James Brown is saying, "Who the hell is this guy Pacheco?" Well, that shows you that Latin music is not only a New York. Obviously, we all knew that not just a New York phenomenon, but it's a worldwide treasure. One of the things that struck me about both of these books was, first of all, how Cuban music, really Latin music, Latin jazz was affected, adapted by the U.S. market, U.S. audiences, and how U.S. audiences influenced this type of music from the beginning. And Chris, you point out something that I think I'd like to focus on, really three things, and they all have to do with race and how race and the perception of Cubans as exotic, so to speak, influences the development of the music, the marketing of the music, and is seen even till in recent years. And there's that tension that you point out in the early 1920s when Cuban bands are marketing themselves by emphasizing their uniqueness, their exoticism, their blackness, their primitive nature. It's a caricature, but it's something that they're using to market themselves. And at the same time, they are struggling with, in more recent years, and even then, actually, to be considered as part of the mainstream of jazz. So you have this tension between the exoticism that they have to bring to the market in order to be able to sell their music, also with their frustration on not being considered part of Latin jazz per se. No one really illustrates it more than your story on Ray Barreto. Ray Barreto is at the Blue Note, wants to play with Johnny Griffin and Horace Silver in the straight jazz medium, and he can't. He's not successful. More recently at the Lincoln Center Jazz Orchestra, you point that out. And it's not only limited to this white and Latino divide, but you also see it in the Apollo Theater. You point that out, how they had a very strict policy of separating Black musicians from Latino acts, and how that the two of them were never allowed to meet. The point that I think is sometimes ignored in the Dizzy Gillespie Chano Pozo collaboration that you mentioned, Chris, is how this collaboration overcomes the otherness that you mentioned by focusing not on their differences but on their shared African roots, and that's revolutionary, right? It's a political statement. So Cuba, to use the Dizzy term, is a statement of Pan-Africanism in the 1940s, and that's how they transcend their differences. And more recently, and this goes to Ben's point, I found his discussion of the Marielito boat lift in 1980 as how that affected the racial undertones of Latin music in the U.S. because the musicians who come in the Mario boat lift were Afro-Cubans, many of them, who were proud of their Black heritage or Black roots. They brought religious rituals with them and religious knowledge to their new land, and they embraced their Afro-Cuban roots, right? They wanted to express their devotion to their gods. And the interesting thing there is that, at least what I gather, is that perhaps because of that emphasis on their African roots, that music doesn't cross over as much as other types of Latin music. So I'd like you, both of you, at some point to really talk about the racial undertones and how that changes. And then the second thing that I would ask, and this comes from Ben's, the conclusion of Ben's book, he talks about the physical and metaphysical aspects of clave. And both of you have mentioned clave. For those of us who can't carry a tune, I think it'd be useful for you to talk about that, how clave is incorporated in New York in a different fashion, perhaps, than it's incorporated in the Caribbean, in music from the Caribbean. So those two things, racial undertones, the development of racial undertones, and the distinctions in clave that both of you allude to in your books. And again, thank you for writing these two works. They are, I learned a lot and really I enjoyed it. So take it away.
Thank you, Jose, and for those wonderful comments and those really complicated questions you just posed to Ben and I. But they're great questions. Mm-hmm. Ben, do you mind if I talk about race a little bit first? And I think that, thank you for that. The issue that we have in the United States, as most of you know, is with Plessy versus Ferguson, the court case. It basically created a legal system that's Black and white, and a social system that's Black and white. And so that our conceptions of race in this country are not polychromatic, but they're just this binary, and they have been so. That case was, I think it was in 1896. Jose, you probably know as the lawyer. And what that did is it transformed the way we othered one another, the way we saw one another, but it basically erased the real cultural differences and the racial differences that are actually reside in this country. And it created a major problem from New Orleans in particular, because New Orleans is culturally more a Caribbean city. It was politically more a Caribbean city, and it did not have a binary racial conception because of the Creole classes, which tended to be mixed and everything in between. So it was really a three-tiered system that was tied to economics and political power and society. And indeed, the early musicians saw it that way. And all of a sudden, it was kind of this artificial imposition from the North to change. And New Orleans changed very slowly. And that's one of the key ideas, is that there was this kind of collaboration that happened because New Orleans was the way it was. And Ben talked about these teachers that were part of that. I mean, the main clarinet teachers were Mexican, from the Teal family, who taught all of the major jazz clarinetists early on and really shaped the sound of early jazz. And so we have this artificial system of race. And so as we progress through history, right, in the middle of the century, what happened is that as jazz becomes more and more important, then there were a significant number of researchers, mostly white men, in the beginning and middle of the century, that started to write jazz histories. And the jazz narratives that they write are not seeing jazz in this polychromatic way, but they're really starting to erase that those differences, which erases cultural difference, which erases the Caribbean, which erases Latin American influence. When you call it just black and white, it also erases Native American influence, it erases Asian influence. There's so many influences that automatically get taken out. And then when it is spoken about as a musical expression that comes from African American culture, it certainly does. But what is African American culture? There's a lot of diversity that's there in those early influences. And why Andy Gonzalez was saying what he was saying in that clip, Ben, that was a great clip to play, that James Brown, you can hear the same thing that's going on in Cuban music. That's because James Brown's music is really influenced by the traditions in New Orleans and that whole trajectory. And indeed, rhythm and blues have the same kind of rhythmic foundations that we have. But when we start writing, histories as jazz progresses throughout the 20th century and becomes more and more economically marginalized, then there's less resources to draw from. All of a sudden, then it becomes even more political to define jazz in very narrow ways in order to consolidate power and to consolidate resources. And again, what gets erased? You look at like Ken Burns's jazz on PBS, which was a major milestone in terms of recognizing the history of jazz. And is Latin jazz or Caribbean musicians even mentioned in that? Very, very briefly. It's almost like it doesn't exist. And when compilations of Louis Armstrong's music get played and the peanut vendor is missing, and the peanut vendor was his biggest hit of 1930 and 1931, and it's erased from those compilations. Why? Because it doesn't quite fit neatly into the narrative that, oh, jazz starts in New Orleans, it's a black music, it comes from these musicians, and as you follow that trajectory, it's moving slowly and slowly into the realm of art music. Well, what happens when the number one hit song is a Cuban pop song, right? And it's in the jazz world. It's a problem. And the same thing happened with Stan Getz and Charlie Byrd when they did Desafinado. And that came out in the 1960s and went to number one. It was charting in pop charts as well. And what do you do with that? These are jazz musicians playing music, and all of a sudden it's becoming successful. And Quincy Jones, the great producer, was interviewed. They asked him what the definition of a jazz record is. He said, it's anything that sells under 10,000 copies. As soon as it goes over 10,000 copies, it's not a jazz record anymore. So now genre contestation is mixed up now with this race. And what ends up happening is no one's talking about this very significant contribution of musicians from the Caribbean, and also the whole history that is the reason why our country is the way it is no longer seen that way. It's like European traditions and African traditions and like nothing in between. And indeed, it was Dizzy Gillespie that met Chano Pozo, and in his book, he has this very interesting quote. He said, you know, Chano didn't speak English and I didn't speak Spanish, but it didn't matter because we both spoke African. In other words, it was a recognition of these shared roots. And it was at the moment, right? The mid-1940s, that is exactly the point where the civil rights movement is just beginning, and these Pan-African congresses are starting to take place. The writings of Marcus Garvey are starting to resonate and really take hold in a lot of different places. And that is exactly the moment when these two musicians come together and formulate this new language of music. And of course they need to call it something different. And of course it gets tied up to politics as well. But if we step back for a moment right now and we say, wait a minute, what happened? Who are our pop stars today? Where did J-Lo come from? Where did Marc Anthony come from? Where do these traditions come from? And Christina Aguilera, and it goes on and on. Why is Beyonce putting out videos where she's impersonating Santeria ceremonies? What is going on here? Why is that now the center of US popular culture? And if you don't take a moment to understand the history that both Ben and I are writing, you can't understand why we are at today where Puerto Ricans can finally be the big pop stars of the day. Why, you know, and why is it that Daddy Yankee is so popular right now? Well, because these things are have all been in place for years and years, and we're finally seeing the recognition and the fruition of these processes of this whole legacy of contributions to global culture coming from these very small Caribbean islands that have incredibly influenced the soundscapes of our modern lives.
I would just chime in. That was great, Chris. And just in terms of, I think, looking at race, the way I specifically look at race in this book and in my previous book is, you know, it's I guess it gets back to who gets to tell the story and what they tell in that story. You know, something like Latin music, you know, there have been a significant number of African-American musicians involved in Latin music, too. It's not a one-way street of Latinos playing in jazz bands. And in one chapter of my book, I deal specifically with Panamanian musicians because Panamanian musicians, many of them left Panama because they were felt excluded in their own country. They had mastered Cuban music, they mastered Panamanian music, they mastered American pop music. But many of them, their parents and grandparents, even if their parents were born in Panama and they had originally, their family had originally come from Jamaica, Barbados, or someplace else, as late as the 1950s, they weren't considered to be citizens and they had to be naturalized in their own country. And that hurt a lot of people, understandably. It wasn't limited to people of color in Panama. It also happened to Hindus and Jews and other groups of people, but specifically how people felt about it and how they dealt with it is something I deal with in my book. Panamanian musicians could adopt the identity of being West Indian. They could adopt the identity of being Latino, and they could also adopt the identity of being African American in the musical setting, and also where they lived and culturally how they identified themselves. Some musicians played in calypso bands. We both know Gene Jefferson did that, Frank Anderson did that, and some musicians strictly went into jazz. Some people went into the world of pop music. Some people went into Broadway because Broadway was a great way to make money and the lights were low and it didn't really matter what color you would. You were just judged on base whether if you could do a good job or not. Some musicians articulated that, and that's in my book. With respect to what you were talking about with the Mariel boat lift, we have to recognize that the vast majority of Cuban migration and settlement in the United States prior to the Cuban Revolution was largely Cubans who were of European descent. And even in places like Union City in West New York, Hudson County, the settlement prior to the revolution was people from Villa Clara and Fomento, chain migration from primarily white Cuban settlement. And then in 1959, the post-1959, the number of people who came to the United States, not just musicians, but who were Cubans of color, was very small. Once 1980 happens and the Mariel boat lift happens, you have a real influx of Afro-Cuban culture and Cubans of color. And that does shift the landscape here in New York. And I think it does shift the landscape in other parts of the United States, specifically because of the refugee resettlement program. So there's a few things that this results in. One is, as you mentioned, a real focus and resurgence in ritual drumming, different religions, palo, santeria, different types of reinvigorations of espiritismo, anything that would involve drumming and religion, but also of new musical information. Because I think really if we look at Latin music and Cuban musical history, it's really about the new musical information being put into the next practice. And then people learning that coming from every country, coming from the Dominican Republic, Panama, Puerto Rico, Americans, learning whatever the new information is. So these musicians in 1980 come and they bring with them the new information. They bring songo. They bring the most up-to-the-date point of playing rumba. They bring you know, the latest slang. And the same thing happens after that. Those people set the framework for people who are coming with, as barceros in 93, 94, and invigorating that scene as well. So come 1980, you know, it's an explosion of Afro-Cuban culture, and it's not just in the Cuban community where you feel this. You've had places like Soundscape and the New Rican Village, which became a home for these musicians like Regino Tellechea and Daniel Ponce and Orlando Puntilla Rios, and they were all able to have a place to perform their music and their concepts with musicians who were here already, who were interested in folklore and interested in jazz, like Mario Rivera and Hilton Ruiz and Steve Berrios and Andy and Jerry Gonzalez, et cetera, et cetera. So there's that happening. And then these musicians were also, some of them were going on to play with jazz bands. You have people like Gabriel Machado Chinchilita, who was playing percussion with Lionel Hampton. You had Ignacio Berroa. Paquito de Rivera is not a Marielito in the sense that he got in a boat and came here, but he came at the same time period, and he started playing with jazz groups and was also playing with traditional Cuban ensembles, something he did not do in Cuba. So the last group of people that was profoundly impacted by this very proud Afro-Cuban cohort of musicians were all the Puerto Rican musicians who were really interested in folklore. The guys who were drumming in Central Park, the men and women who danced and wanted to know more about Orisha music and Palo and so forth. And they were mentored by this whole generation of musicians like Manuel Martinez Olivera and Felipe Garcia Villamil. So there was a group of people who were teaching and a group of people who were hunger, who had a great hunger to learn this information, and who were just, you know, they couldn't go to Cuba. So this was the most incredible thing that could happen to them. Because you have to remember that most of this musical information was the sort of religious stuff was kept secret to a certain extent. And the older musicians who were here didn't want to teach people a lot of that stuff. So when these individuals came in 1980, and not just men, there are important women who were instructors like Xiomara Rodriguez and Rita Macias and others who taught people Orisha dance because it wasn't taught here really that much before. So, you know, it's I think there are many layers to the conversation about race, and, you know, it impacted education, it impacted musical practice, it impacted the ways in which people decided to represent themselves professionally and socially. And as Chris suggested prior to me jumping in here, these are processes that have been happening in this country before we were here. But I think with the Cuban and Spanish Caribbean and West Indian component coming into this conversation, it makes it more rich. It also complicates a lot of these conversations in a good way and an important way in terms of how we look at music and this binary notion, kind of the silliness of it. Or if you want to look at it on a continuum, you can do that as well. But I think it's always important to, as I try to do, is let the musicians talk about it, let them speak about their experience, and some incredible things come out, because it wasn't all roses. That's the other thing. It wasn't like everyone got together and it was great. I mean, Nick Rodriguez, he talks about when he goes to play with Jelly Roll Morton, the first thing they did was after a couple of gigs, they go get the S book. And he's like, what's the S book? And, you know, S standing for a four-letter word. It was the hardest book they had, and they put it in front of him and they made him play it. But he got through it. It was a hazing. It was trying to see, you know, if he could cut it, if he could really play all this music. So I think, you know, it was a space where people could come together and test each other out. And as Chris points out, there are some lifelong relationships that these musicians talked about and would tell us about. I'm positive about that. But it didn't always start in a place of mutual respect and understanding. But I think those conversations happened on the bandstand in pretty incredible ways.
Let me just ask one more question, then Meg, credit.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
So, and Chris, both you and Ben, and I'd like both of you to talk about this, you know, throughout your book, there are several mentions of clave, right? Of the pattern that's associated with Cuban music, musical pattern, and how it in New York, at least, it's observed in a different way than in Cuba, how it develops. Talk a little bit, start with you, Chris, if you can. Ben calls it the physical and metaphysical aspects of clave, so I'll let him go second. But to talk a little bit about clave and maybe even start with an explanation of what clave is.
Well, claves are instruments. They're usually two wooden sticks that are hit together. Fernando Ortiz claims that it's derived from clavijas, which are wooden pegs that are found on old ships that hold sails in place, and that clavijas were transformed into instruments on those ships bringing enslaved peoples over, and eventually continued to be used as rhythmic timekeepers and timelines in the traditions, the kind of the Neo-African traditions emerging in the Caribbean. That's one explanation of the history of that instrument. But what it is it plays a very fundamental role in Afro-Cuban expression in a lot of different, not every Cuban music, and Ben's an expert in some of this as well, especially the ones that don't use clave, but in particular, but clave is also a key, right? Mm-hmm. It's like but it's not a key like into a door. It's a key. Steve Cornelius, the percussionist, talks about it this way. It's the key like a keystone in an arch doorway of stones. If you notice, when there's an arch stone doorway, at the top there'll be a rock that's shaped like this. It's the keystone, and it holds all the other rocks in place. And that's the function that clave plays, that rhythm, that bop, 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 is one version of the clave. In Cuban dance music and Latin jazz that use Afro-Cuban music, it is the rhythm that all the musicians must feel in sync in order to align all their parts together. And it's the rhythmic foundation of the music. So in some ways it's, you know, everybody needs to be feeling the clave in the same place in order for the musicians to align their parts. Sometimes it's sounded out in performance and other times it's not. But it would be something in the dancers as well. But I'll let Ben's got a great riff on clave, so I'll let Ben take over from that.
Ben?
Yeah, sorry, I always have to remember to unmute there. I mean, Chris gave you a really good idea of how the clave functions. If you really want to go in deep, let's go in deep. The clave is a timeline pattern that is obviously coming to us from West Africa. It's a reduction of a longer timeline pattern. The one that we have now is five attacks that he's talking about. We can have variations within those attacks, but it's a cycle. It's a circle that repeats. So you can think about it like a piece of chocolate cake. If you have chocolate cake with different layers of frosting in it, the clave is really the frosting that's holding the whole thing together. So if you were to slice into that cake and look at it with all these layers, you would see the music is held together, and it's, more importantly, it's stratified. So every piece of musical information that's coming around in that cycle, in that piece of cake or whatever you want to, you want to think about it, it's stratified over this timeline. So the bass has to fall in line with this timeline, as Chris explained. All the percussion parts, the singer as the singer sings, as the composer composes, as anything that would happen in this music is going to use that as a reference point. Sometimes that timeline pattern is articulated, sometimes it isn't. And not all Cuban music uses this timeline. There are plenty of styles of Cuban music that have the clave and then completely ignore it, such as Punto Guajiro or Música Campesina. Same thing with genres like changui. There's no clave in changui. The tres starts with what's called a tumbao or la llamada de montuno a few times, and then the band just enters and everybody just has to know where the downbeat is. There's no clave organizing the music. There's no, that pattern is not happening as a means of orienting, as Chris said, the musicians. Now, in terms of the physical and metaphysical aspects of it, metaphysical aspects, you might look at the clave as sort of tension and release, negative and positive. Some people may say male and female. That's because you have the three attack side and the two attack side. It doesn't matter which one you want to say is which, but the three attack size is really, there's an unbalancing, because in the space of four pulses, you have three attacks. Ba, 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 ba. And then it resolves on that second side. So you have that tension. Da, da, da. One, two, three, four. One, two, and three, four. One, two, three, four. One, two, and three, four. Right? The tension release. And I think musicians in their conversations in talking about the clave have discussed that historically. I think that's what I'm getting at with the metaphysical. We don't have to take it too far, but it is at the root. And in places like New York, it is so elevated to such an extent that even I would say this, and I have said this before, and I say this in the book, that in New York, people took the clave so seriously and continue to, that there are things that you just don't do when you're playing clave-based music that other places allow to happen. Here, musicians are very conscious in their arrangements and their performance of where the clave is, knowing what to play at the right time. If you're on the three side of the clave, ba, 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 and you're playing a montuno, a tumbao over the montuno section, your part cannot coincide. You cannot play with that first downbeat. That is incorrect, right? If you were to play a downbeat, you would have to start on the other side of the clave. So there's that level of precision and consciousness. There are musicians who tap their foot while the clave pattern while they're playing a song to make sure that they're there. They listen to certain instruments to make sure if they happen to get off, how to reorient themselves. And if a piece of music is written so that there is a discrepancy or a jump within that piece of music, musicians here in New York, particularly someone like Sonny Bravo, who I write about in my book, will add a measure or delete a measure or add extra measures so that the clave starts in one point and ends in the same position at the end of the song. You can follow it all the way through. And there are books that exhort the practitioner to do this from an early time period. The earliest reference I found to this was in 1941 or 1942, a book by a musician named Phil Rail, telling people that if you're going to play the claves, that it has to start and has to end in the same place. So in recordings by people like Eddie Palmieri of classic Cuban compositions like La Negra Tomasa, Bilongo, by Rodriguez Fife, he will add an extra measure so that coming out of the bridge of the song, the clave stays exactly the same as where they started it. So I think there's this seriousness so that the clave even gets imposed upon other genres that don't even deal with clave. For example, Puerto Rican plena and bomba and Dominican merengue are genres of music where arrangers, Cuban arrangers, New York-based arrangers, will mark the clave pattern underneath so that the arrangement also stays in clave. But if you go to those countries, if you talk to practitioners who play merengue típico from El Cibao or who play plena, they do not think of the clave in terms of organizing their music whatsoever. So I think that's really sort of the penetration, if you will, and the weight of the clave as a musical concept in Caribbean music that I think really emanates from this point of New York City. Because if you look at Cuban music today, there are countless examples where the clave is kind of disregarded in popular arrangements. And there are many examples in the 60s, 70s, and 80s of recordings where this happens. And people in other countries, and also in Cuba, they don't necessarily, in certain contexts, won't get very upset by it. But I think here in New York, Latin jazz musicians and musicians who are dedicated to this theme take it quite seriously.
Thank you, Ben.
Thank you.
Jose, do you have anything else you'd like to add?
No, not at all. Please, take it away.
Okay. Gretchen, do you have a question?
Yes, we have questions. So both Ramos posted on the Q&A box. Please explain further the push-pull of the French Caribbean history to New Orleans in 1716. If you can explain or talk about the segregation, perhaps related to the split of the Latin to Latin jazz. And to Chris, for all practical purposes, what would be the proper nomenclature of the Latin jazz?
Hey, Bob, thank you for the questions and thanks for tuning in. It's great to see your name there and great questions. The proper nomenclature for Latin jazz, I would say like great music, groovy music. That would be the best. As soon as you get into the naming game, then it's a problem. And that's what I talk about. It's really, it's about genre contestation and all of the economic, social, and political issues and racial issues and national issues of nationalism, cultural identity that play out in that. It's a fascinating topic to explore. But in terms of the real music, like, you know, it's funny when I play with Eddie Palmieri, we get booked on Latin jazz festivals and we get booked on salsa festivals. And he brings the same band to both. He'll just leave the singer home on one of them. And so I asked Eddie, I said, you know, are you playing, what festival are you playing? He goes, oh, I left Herman home because it's a Latin jazz, so they just want to have instrumental stuff. But we play the same tunes, we just do instrumental versions of them, and we play them the same way. And he said, hey, a gig's a gig. It's not my job to police what Latin jazz is or what salsa is. And I think a lot of musicians think about it. It's economics. A gig is a gig. And so you want to call me a Latin jazz band and then I get booked in a Latin jazz gig? Great. If you want to call me a jazz band so I get booked in the jazz festival? Great. And so I think that's, in terms of the naming, the what to actually call it, is less interesting than what actually people choose to call it and why. Was it Duke Ellington that said there's only two types of music in this world, good and bad music? So, but Gil Evans came along and said, the bad music is even better. You learn more from bad music than you learn from good music. I'll leave the comment that you just put in there on its own. I'm not going to respond to that one, Bob, but thank you for that chat. And then in terms of the French influence, that's really complicated to answer quite quickly. But in some regards, the French colonial powers, it was they were the first administrators of New Orleans, and then it went to the Spanish and back to the French, kind of went back and forth. But one of the things that was of interest is French culturally thought that and knew that it was very important to support cultural expressions. And they would promote that. And it's a way of creating communal glue and peace. And so it was one of the reasons why Congo Square was promoted and was allowed to happen, was it was because of the French administrators viewing it as a very important step for the enslaved peoples to actually have an avenue for their cultural expression, for them to maintain some of these cultural traditions. And it was a pressure valve, of course, to keep the peace in these very problematic social settings of unequal power distribution between peoples. And I think I'll leave it at that, but it was really it was because of the French administration that actually the drums were not outlawed, and that there was, and because it was a Catholic country, it was promoting these kind of synthesized and traditions that would eventually emerge as these neo-West African traditions, now known as Santeria, for instance.
And?
I'm not quite sure what I understand. The question was about Jose mentioned about segregation. Was that vis-a-vis Cuban musicians, or I'm not understanding what the question is. Maybe you can type it in there, but I'll answer. There was a question about somebody asked, Leslie Haynes. Nice to see you, Leslie. Asked about the tension release, and I just spoke about that. That's any timeline pattern, West African timeline pattern, I would venture to say, or most, let's say, because there's probably going to be something that's going to prove me incorrect. But let's just say in the case of clave or in the case of the classic bembe timeline pattern, anything that is heavily syncopated on one end, and when you get to the end of the cycle, it evens out. The evening out is the release part of it. So in the case of a 3-2 clave, the 3 side would be the tense side, the 2 side would be the release side, because it's 2 even attacks. So that's what I'm talking about, tension release. If we make that pattern longer, like, but right, any place where there's heavy upbeats, that's going to be your tension, and any place where there's downbeats that fall on the main pulse, that's going to be the release. So segregation, still not exactly quite sure what the question.
Here's the question. Yeah. I'll read it from Bob Ramos. Ben, if you can talk about the segregation Jose just mentioned, perhaps related to the split of Latin / jazz. So maybe Jose, you wanna explain what you were thinking of that Bob Ramos picked up on?
Yes, can you, I'm not on mute, right?
Pardon, yes, you are.
Okay. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Can you, yes, we can hear you.
So, no, look, I there's a theme in both books of both Latin musicians being put in a box. And I think it was Ray Barreto that called it a Latin ghetto. With a commercial need to be seen as different, to be seen as unique. For one thing, that made them less threatening. It also allowed them, I think, Chris, you point this out, it allowed them to take some liberties, such as something I didn't know, Don Aspiazu incorporating Black musicians in his band way before Benny Goodman gets credit for doing that. And at the same time, suffering or being fired by the Rainbow Room for wanting to play straight ahead jazz as opposed to Latin music. So it's this, what I was trying to talk about was both the tension between the commercial and the musical desires on the part of the musicians, as well as their need to, or their desire to wanting to, to expand, to play other types of music. Is not limited to the black and white binary point, but it, as I mentioned, you see it at the Apollo, where you have the split between Black, Latin.
Yeah, I think that this is not a one-size-fits-all history. And I think there are many, many examples of people who blow that notion out of the water. You know, early on, prior to Chick Webb or any of these other groups having long residencies at the Savoy and places like that, you had Panamanian musicians who were really doing well in New York City. You had someone like Vernon Andrade, who had African-American band members in his band. And he, started out playing at the Renaissance and other ballrooms, calling the shots as a band leader and having the longest residency of any band leader, Black, white, or Latino, in New York prior to any of these people. Then you had people like Frank Anderson, who would play everything, show music, Latin music, calypso, and then would form his own big band to express his own sense of identity. It was called Frank Anderson and the Pan American Big Band, which played, tabolga and vals peruano and Cuban music, and had the members of that band included fellow Panamanians, but also members of Count Basie and Duke Ellington's band. And then you have, you know, other extreme, you know, examples of that. So I think for every case of dissatisfaction rightfully felt by someone like Ray Barreto, you would also have many stories of people who chose other paths. There's a long history of Puerto Rican musicians playing jazz in the United States and going under the radar, not being identified as Puerto Rican. Roger Ram Ramirez, composer of Loverman, Carmelo Jari, who played in Jelly Roll Morton's band, just a long a list of people. And I think there was a level of interaction between African-Americans and Latinos that people don't talk about in terms of educating one another. In the case of Socaraz, in the case of Nick Rodriguez, in the case of Margaret Bonds, who was Eddie Palmieri's piano teacher, as Eddie Palmieri also studied with Edwiges Bocanegra, who was a black woman from Guayama in Puerto Rico. So, you know, it was, where can I get the best education? Same thing with a great piano player like Paquito Pastor, Afro-Puerto Rican, incredible musician. His piano teachers, when I talked to him, were American Jewish women. So I think that, you know, we have these stories, we do have this narrative, but at the same time, we have many stories that kind of add up to give us a complete, another picture of the ways in which people sought out performance opportunities, sought to form their own bands, sought to educate themselves, and sought to avoid, if they could, being pigeonholed and being placed in situations where, oh, I can only do this, or I don't look Latin, even though I am Latin. You know, that kind of sentiment, I tried to get at as much of that as I can in the book, because I think some of the stories are truly amazing. You know, Enid Lowe is a Panamanian jazz singer. In Panama, she sang with all the great bands and recorded with Jan Garber and so on and so forth, and comes to New York and is playing with jazz trios and so forth with her husband, who's Panamanian. Just another example of musicians of color from the Caribbean who choose to mark a path that would perhaps put them in the mainstream of one particular genre and market, but also would work in other genres, because it was all just music, as Chris just got finished saying. There was no difference between going to a calypso gig, going to play a Broadway show gig, going to play a classical gig, and then going to play with a Latin dance band. It was all about making the money, playing the gigs, and exceeding at your profession. You know, Victor Paz just passed away a couple days ago, arguably one of the most you know, well-respected, in-demand trumpet players in the last 50 years, I'd say, played.
Not arguably, the best.
Yeah. You know, he's on every hit Latin record, from Eddie Palmieri to Tito Rodriguez to Tito Puente. He's on every Broadway show. He played on television. I mean, it's endless. And he spent, I don't know how much he loved playing in Broadway, but he was damn good at it. And he was the king of session work, an all black Panamanian man who came to New York. And a lot of people came to New York to up their game, as is in their musical chops, whether it was from the Dominican Republic, people like Crispin Fernandez or Juan Colon, who came here specifically to get lessons with a guy like Nick Rodriguez and Socaraz, and then to play fourth alto in Tito Puente's band so they could practice reading. And then on a Thursday or Friday, they would go play in Lynn Oliver's band for $5 and read through big band charts to practice their sight reading, and then take classical lessons at the same time. It was about pushing the music to the next level, because this is where the best players were, and this is where the state of the art was in the music. So I'm not saying that, you know, race is not important, because it definitely is important. I spent a good deal talking about it in the band. But when it comes to the bandstand, and it comes to getting the job done, and it comes to playing with the feel of the music and nailing your part and getting called to do the gig again, that was the primary concern, the primary objective of all of these people who play this music. I think the other stuff in terms of expressing your personal vision of the world, or what you see needs fixing in the world, or your experience of the world, all valid, all there, and an important part of this discussion. But in terms of the bandstand, in terms of the keeping the focus on the music being number one and doing the best possible job, these people have set the bar so high and the expectations so great of all of us who step on the bandstand with them or after them, that a lot of these issues, while we might talk about them here and now in this very necessary and timely way on the bandstand, a lot of this stuff is, I don't want to say it's put off to the side and forgotten, because that's not true. But I think on the bandstand, the music really takes supremacy, and anything that gets in the way of that mission of playing the best possible music for most of these musicians, and I would think, I would let Chris definitely speak to this if he wants to add to it, I think that is the ultimate goal, to make the best music, to make the most swinging music, to play the parts the most correctly, to play exactly as the arranger intended it. And it's the dancer has to keep dancing, because this is also dance music. Now, if it's Latin jazz and it's supposed to be listened to, we can get back to that conversation. But all of these musicians who played Latin jazz, as Chris talked about earlier, like Ray Barreto and others, they were playing dance music. So it's this knowledge, it's a body of knowledge, being able to call on that body of knowledge and put it out there at any time. Chris, I remember you talked about one time in going on a gig with Tito, and they lost the book of music for the horns, and he had to sit there. You got bumped up to first class, and you got to watch him, and he wrote out all of the charts for the horns by pencil on the flight over to where. Well, you tell the story.
The only thing we had was a blue Bic pen.
Uh-huh.
And he sat there, I got a first class ticket by accident going down to Argentina, and Tito sat down next to me. It was right when I was writing my book, so I was like, oh, this is great. I'll interview him for 9 hours, and we were talking, and all of a sudden, in the midst of it, he said, oh no, I forgot the charts. And it was a special concert where we were with Celia Cruz, and we were with Oscar de Leon, I think a few other artists, and so everybody was doing like three songs. He was like, how many songs do I have? And I said, well, you have three. And we weren't with his band, we were with the RMM All-Star Band. And so he said, what's the horn section? And I told him there were seven horns and what they were. And he's like, do you have any music paper? And this is back when you would carry music paper, and not, they wouldn't be on computers. And I gave it to him, but we didn't have a pencil, and no one around us did. So he had to do it in blue, a big pen. But that's significant in the sense that he wrote for memory. He rearranged everything for those seven horns. And for a band leader and a percussionist at that, to be able to do that and have that kind of level of musicianship was just inspirational for me. And without a piano or anything, he just did it from his head. And when we got to he handed me the parts and he said, hand them out when we get to the rehearsal or the sound check. And we did that. And there wasn't one mistake in all of them. And then at the end of the gig, I collected the parts for him. I said, you want these back? He goes, no, I got the originals there. You can keep them. So I still have them in his hand, that blue pick pen. It was just an amazing moment. But yeah, he did it. And Leslie, I see in the chat, he did attend Juilliard as well. But he was just an all-around musician. It's something that you don't get from band leaders, but you get it from that generation, like Leslie, like your dad, that generation where they're just all-around musicians and expected that. And I think, Ben, I think you made a really important point that, you know, Duke Ellington said, music is my mistress, right? And the reason he said that was because it was the most important thing once the musicians are on the bandstand, it's the music that matters, and cultural difference doesn't, or it's there, but it's not as high. And if a musician doesn't have that attitude, they don't get hired for that gig anymore. But it also is the reason why music is the only art form that tells the future. And it's very special that way. You know, it's just if sound in general tells our future, right? We have a very acute sense of hearing because that's how we survived when we were in the wilderness and and wild animals were out there that could eat us. We weren't on the top of the food chain. You could hear them coming before they came. Or it's like walking down the street and you hear a siren and you know an ambulance is coming before you see it. That's the function of music in society. Music sounds out what's going to come. And musicians are in a very powerful and interesting position in society because they're visionaries. And so you can see, like Don Aspiazo and the Havana Casino Orchestra, that was racial integration before racial integration was even thought possible in this country. And they were playing in clubs in Harlem, and they were playing in clubs for a bunch of white people with Afro-Cubans, light-skinned Cubans, and everything in between. And no one blinked because, first of all, as Jose pointed out, in a black-white society, when Mario Balzao would go, a very dark-skinned Afro-Cuban man would go into a restaurant, a white restaurant, for whites only, and order, and they would say, you have to leave, there are no blacks here. His response was, in a very thick Cuban accent, I'm not black, I'm Cuban. And it would stun people, and they would have no idea how to respond to that, and then usually end up serving him. And that was the role he had in Chick Webb's band when they were traveling down south, and the band needed to eat, they'd send him into the restaurant to get the food for the band. And with these black bands. At the same time, he couldn't perform the way he looked with the white bands of the day. But Don Aspiazo could, because they were billed as something different and Cuban. And at the same time, it happened on the dance floors as well. Leslie, you'll appreciate this comment. At the Palladium, it was the first integrated dance floor in the world. And it kind of signified what was going to come. And at the same time, it was because of the musicians that were playing and the type of music that they were playing, and that music was the most important thing that was in the room at that time. And it allowed people to express visions of the world as it should be, as it could be, and as it would be. And that's what musicians do when we play.
You know, Chris, I was just thinking really quick of you keep mentioning Aspiazo, and I read in your book as well. And I keep thinking of those recordings that Aspiazo made in the 30s where it's singing in English. The covers of Arsenio Rodriguez's Ruñidera in English is something like, I want a whole lot. It almost sounds like I want a whole lot of love, like Led Zeppelin, but it's like, I want a love. You know, so Aspiazo, Cuban musician, singing songs by a black Cuban man, Arsenio Rodriguez, in English. And then I fast forward to 1980, 81, 82, and you have Totico y sus Rumberos singing Don and John's doo-wop hit, What's Your Name? Is it Mary or Sue? Over a rumba with bata drums. So like you said, you know, the groundwork for all of this has been laid a long time ago. And there's really nothing new in it, maybe in the marketing sense, but we have many examples going back over 100 years of these things happening in this music. And it's just a question of, you know, putting it together in a long view. And then also, which I think we both try to do, look at it in the very particular. And try to show how the very particular instances of how this happens reflect the larger picture.
Thank you.
Yeah, we have more questions, but no more time.
Right, precisely. And I think both Ben and Chris and Jose have really pulled this together and made some very remarkable comments that hopefully we will pursue in the fall of 2020. Two, when we have an arts festival that will feature jazz, Latin jazz, and groovy jazz, and all sorts of other musics, etc. So I'd like to thank our speakers tonight, Chris Washburne, whose book is right here, Latin jazz. And then, how do you pronounce your last name?
Well, in Brooklyn, we say Lapidus, but...
Okay, Lapidus, whose book is right here, which is also good for building up your muscles. And Jose, who joined us with some very incisive questions. So I want to thank all of our speakers tonight, as well as our indefatigable expert on technology and everything else, Gretchen Sanchez, as well as our attendees. And we're sorry you couldn't answer all of the questions, but the next time we have another gathering, we will make sure we answer your questions at that stage. Thank you all very much on behalf of the CUBA program of Columbia University. And until the next time, keep playing music. Thank you.
Thank you.